continue on with our summer series, our backyard theology, going through a number of topics about Jesus and his ways, and putting them simply, putting them simply. We even have a definition in today's message that has no words. How about that? Is that pretty simple? There's no words? Well, last week, Pastor Dale talked about salvation, how Jesus saves us from sin, saves us from spiritual death, saves us from ourselves. And at the very end of his message, he talked about that Jesus saves us for something. He saves us for a purpose. This morning is all about that purpose. It's all about that. And our church has a purpose as well. Just to remind people who've been here a while about our purpose, and for new people to give you a sense of what the purpose of the river is, take a look at this message.
The opportunity to hear what I did for them and of my love for them.
Andrew was skeptical, as angels can be, and said, but what if Peter and James and John grow weary? And what about the people after them? What if they forget? What about it? What's your plan then? Jesus said, I don't have another plan. That is my plan. That they would tell others and show others. And they would tell others and show others until the good news is preached to everyone in the planet. Well, that is God's plan. That is what Peter and James and John faithfully did. And they passed it on to others who faithfully told and showed others of God's love. 20 centuries later, that's still the plan. Jesus does not have another plan. How are we doing as a church about that? How are you doing with that plan? Let's go to the scriptures. All the scriptures today that I'll be reading are taken from the Message Bible. The Message Bible gives a good punch to things. The Message Bible gives a slant that emphasizes action words, and I just love it. Let's start with Mark 12, verses 28 to 31. One of the religious scholars came up to Jesus, hearing the lively exchanges and questions and answers, and seeing how sharp Jesus was at his answers, he put in his question. Which is the most important of all commandments? Jesus said, the first in importance is this. Listen, Israel, the Lord your God is one. So love the Lord God with all your passion and prayer and intelligence and energy. And here is the second. Love others as well as you love yourselves. There's no greater commandment that ranks with these. Did Jesus imply this? Did he say this for a couple people? No, he said this is the most important commandment. That means to do it. This commandment is for you. This commandment is for me. So, welcome to your mission field. There's a big sign. You can't miss it on the way out unless you walk through a fire exit. It says, welcome to your mission field. It's been there for about a year. How many people have seen it? Yeah. Well, now it's there forever. So you have to pass that on the way out. A quick poll of the people here. I'd like to ask you a question. For those who know of God's love, of God's sacrifice, for those who have a relationship with Jesus, you have two choices in this poll. The first, well, the question is how you found God, right? You say, well, I didn't know I was missing. That's a joke. But how did you find God? First option is you found him through your own personal study. You found him through your own means, all by yourself. The second option is somebody helped you. Everybody have one of those two answers? Okay, first one, you found God all by yourself. Where are those people? Hold your hand up. We've got three, four or five. One's my wife. It is possible, and it's true. Okay, now, how many people found God because somebody else helped them? That's most of us. And I found God because she introduced me. My wife, she found God by herself, but she introduced me because of the way she was living. I noticed her life was changing. I was watching and learning, and finally I said, I gotta have what she had. What is it? That's how I came to Christ. The point is that most people need help. Most of us need somebody to introduce us to God. Romans 10 talks about this. Everyone who calls, help God, gets help. But how can people call for help if they don't know who to trust? And how can they know who to trust if they haven't heard of the one who can be trusted? And how can they hear if nobody tells them? And how is anybody going to tell them unless someone is sent to do it. People need to hear from others. That's called mission. Now, the word mission is not found anywhere in the Bible, in any version that I know of. But yet the concept of it is found throughout the Bible. From Abraham, God's call to Abraham, to Jesus calling his disciples to go, to preach, to baptize. The book is a missionary book from beginning to end. Missions is at the very heart of God and will continue until Jesus comes again. Let's take a look at a definition of missions. A definition. Here was the simplest definition I could find that applies to what we're talking about. Missions is what God does through his people, the church, to spread the gospel through word and deed to all people of the world. Can we get simpler than that? Yeah. That's what our series is about, is putting things simply. Too long a definition, too many words. How about this definition? Love God, love people. Is that simpler? Yeah, it is. Love is an action, love is a verb. Love is what we need to do. And Christians call that loving action. They call that by two terms. They call that mission. They call that outreach. And around here, we have two main types of mission or outreach. That's across the street or across the world. Those are the two main areas that we're going to look at today. And then we're going to get really personal and talk about you. So, the first type is community outreach. Our church does so much good stuff at helping families and people in trouble, in need. So much of that's behind the scenes. We're not bragging, we're just telling you there's a lot of that going on. Who's been helped by some of that outreach at some point in their life? Go ahead. I sure have. Here are some of the specific ministries, though, that assist with that. One of them is called the Ark Homeless Shelter, where in winter, when it's coldest, men who don't have any lodging, they come to our church on a rotational basis, 2 or 3 weeks, and then we give them housing, we give them good food, we give them fellowship, encouragement. They are a blessing to our church when they are here, and we love it when they are. The homeless shelter is the first. Take Two is a ministry as well at the river. And they provide three things. They provide assisting women with housing issues. They have a venue called the Java Joint on 8th. They serve up delicious coffee and food and provide employment for people in the program. And it's a great resource center. We have that, the Take Two ministry. Meals ministry is a third one, where for new moms or families undergoing loss, whatever the need is we take meals to people so they don't have to worry about that through the things that they're going through. And a fourth one is the food pantry, where we bring in groceries and then give those to people who are in great need. Those are our local ministries. And then there's the global ministries beyond our communities. Now, when I say global missions, I don't know what comes to your mind. But I remember growing up when I heard something like global missions, or even into my teens, I pictured things like missionaries being boiled in big pots in Africa or something, somewhere in the world, or Bible thumpers, or people who hold those signs, repent or burn, things like that. That's not what we're talking about. So what are we talking about? Let's look at this great verse from Mark chapter 12. Love the Lord God with all your passion and prayer and intelligence and energy, and love others as well as you love yourself. That's what we're talking about by global missions, by missions away from our host city. Love God, love people, do something about it. But here's something even simpler than that. One picture. What's shown in this picture? Shut it up. What is being shown? What? Smiles.
Happiness.
Love. What did you say, Jen?
Happiness.
Happiness.
Food.
Food. Food's always a big part of our missions. Yes, it is. Together. Do you see a comfort level with the people up there? The missionaries are the people in the middle, just in case you don't know. But they, Tony and Jesse, there's a comfort level. It's not standing in front on a podium and preaching at people. It's getting together with people, deserving the right to be a part, building trust. That's what that picture shows. It is fantastic. Okay, we're trying something new today. Please get out your cell phones and turn them on.
Come on. Really?
I'm serious.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Get out your cell phone. Turn it on. Now, there's no cruising Facebook or any of the other sites, but we'll need that later. Thank you for doing that. So where is your mission field? Where is it? Some of you are doing it right now. God bless you. Some of you know what it is, but you don't know how to start it. Some of you don't have a clue, but you need to. And some of you are afraid to ask God the question, God, where's my mission field? Out of fear of what God might ask you to do. I'd like to read you one of my favorite mission quotes that's on my computer. When God puts love and compassion in your heart towards someone, He's offering you an opportunity to make a difference in that person's life. You must learn to follow that love. Don't ignore it, act on it. Somebody needs what you have. Maybe when you watch the news or you hear about injustices in our area, in the world, that there's something that just drives you nuts about something that's wrong. Pastor Dale often says, that's a very good chance that's God telling you to do something about it. That's the Holy Spirit working on you. So what is God putting in your heart? What is there? Oh, I could do something about that. Today's message is for you, friend. Let's take a look at what happens when you go. What happens when you give? Let's take a look at this video.
So I'm swimming my eyes to heaven. God, why don't
okay, let's get the plane. There are two main places that we go for away missions. First of all, there's Wahiwa, Hawaii. Why do we go there? To get out of the cold, because it's in January. No, that's not what we do. We go there because our pastor and his wife have such a heart for the people of Wahiwa, for the people on the island of Oahu. And they've been going for over a decade of helping out there. And if part of the pastor's heart is there, we won't let him get away from us. We're going to go with him. So that's why we go to Wahiwa. And what we do is we partner with ministries out there that are just like us. Kind of weird. Not normal. And it's a great fit. And God moves powerfully. The second place we go is in summer. We go to New Orleans when it's really hot down there. And what we do is we partner with ministries down there, and we feed the homeless, and we work with street kids, and we do all kinds of fantastic stuff. We feed 5,000 people in one day. Okay, we got a little help of like 300 people. But we join in with existing ministries. For both of these missions, what's important is that missionaries who go do what God tells them. We don't say, you gotta go do this. You pray each day. You hear from God. You go and do. With the support of our team, with the support of the local missionaries, doing it God's way, it is fantastic. To all those who have helped and are helping with our local ministries, with our ministries away, God bless you. For those who have helped fund our outreaches on a regular basis, whether local or away, God bless you. Thank you. Now it's time for us to get personal. Hit it. God is going somewhere with this plan for you. He's inviting you to come along for the ride and the new work as well. The issue is whether you will take a leap of faith and say yes to his invitation. If you trust him enough, if you believe, if you really believe that God has a purpose for your life, he does. God has an invitation that is out there for you. Actually, it's a command, but it's also an invitation. And then there's the destination. What it is that God wants to do through you. Little things, big things, all of those are all about your mission field, all about you. These words are for you. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. Because it's time for us to do something. If not now, well then when? When will we see an end to the pain? It's not making something. It's not enough to do nothing. It's time to do something. Between the invitation that is there and between the destination that is there, there comes the part in between. And that's when problems, that's when obstacles come up. And we're going to talk about those right now. There's about six or seven of them. And I know at least one will apply to each. First, there are fears that keep us away from our mission field. All of the what ifs that come that keep us from saying yes to going out. But friends, faith overrides fears. With faith, all things are possible. I've seen people who have needed full-time nurses go off and do away missions with a nurse in hand, overcoming fears. Then there's control over our lives. We like that. Things are comfortable. Things are predictable that way. But God is worthy to be trusted. He has plans for you, and when the Spirit fills you, it takes you further than you can dream of. Ask me. I used to be a control freak. There are distractions and diversions. When you leave on Sunday, when you're getting out of your chair, it's like, yeah, I know I should go do that. But then a giant vacuum is somewhere out there in the lobby, and it sucks everything out of your head before you get to your car. And you say, what was it that we did today?
I don't know, but it was good.
We have to get beyond the distractions. And we have to prayerfully discern, let others help you and try things. For those that are self-absorbed, you need a broader perspective. For people to see people through God's eyes, you can make a difference. When there are doubts that are in the way that God could or would or should use you, know that your life has purpose, your life has meaning. God is with you. For those who have bad pasts, and there's a bunch of us, you've been through rough spots, trouble with the law, addictions, all of that. That doesn't disqualify you. In fact, it uniquely qualifies you. Because people that are lost in those things, you are the hope. You are real. You have made it through or are making it through. And the most effective people are those that are like that. Then there's the procrastinators. Oh, you're up there. You know who you are. I told you to get out your cell phone and you didn't. Now do it. In the words of the great motivator, Arnold Schwarzenegger, do it now. Do it now. Get out your cell phone. Your mission is not about what you can't do, but what you can do. Your limitations aren't important. Your mission is important. What mission field is God calling you to? What's He calling you to? Welcome to your mission. Welcome. While you are thinking, while you are praying, let the Spirit come. Just because you've been active in the past, said, well, it's time for somebody else. Nope. You have breath. There's a reason. There's a reason. Let the Spirit speak to you on what it is that your mission. Who is there in your neighborhood, in your life? So that you don't have this vacuum suck out everything that you just heard. And what the Spirit is speaking to you now, then, I'd like you to text me. In the next 7 days, I will return every phone call for a no-pressure chat on what God is telling you about your mission field. That number is coming up on the screen now. And I want you to just text your name to that number. It's my iPhone. I'll give you a call. No pressure. Find out how it's going. Thank you, friend, whoever just texted. That's what it's about. But there's more than one person here. You're here for a reason. You have a purpose. It's about your present. It's about your future. And we all wish God had purpose and presence and plan. And sometimes we need a little bit of help. Go now, operators are standing by. It's that important. Because one of the main ways that God answers the prayers, God help me. One of the ways that you know, somebody's calling the number. Okay, hotline. One of the ways that God answers the tears is to send His people to reflect Him. To be God with skin on. And in the scriptures it says that we should ask God to give us the nations for His glory. Are you that old? With God, we can do all things. Great song about this. Asking Gretch to come up now. It is a reflection about that.
This song, it has a very unique and dramatic effect in my life every time I sing it. So, I offer that to you now. God has a way of using us. He wants availability more than ability. So with that, we say amen.
Still doubt, God can use you for missions. He says, and then the script, so AB people don't freak out. here's the most effective missionary I've ever met. We were on an Indian reservation in Arizona, working with the church there. And there was a little girl. She could barely walk. She was stunted in size. She was unable to speak. Unable. Never spoke in her whole life. Malformed in a variety of ways. And while we began the work, she got to her feet. She got up and she grabbed a teenage girl around the legs and held her. Just held her. Within seconds, the girl began to weep and to cry. This girl had been through hell from our team. Had been pregnant even. She had so much pain inside. And this little girl, her name is Lata, was able to help this girl release that in her life. And Lata was there the whole week that we were there. And she would go up to this individual, or that individual, or that mountain of a man, and the same thing would happen. There would be a release of pain. Not a word said, not a scripture quoted. That was God's mission for Lala, and still is. You have a mission. Let's pray some old prayers, and then we'll get you out. Holy Spirit, come. Get us beyond ourselves, our hang-ups, our obstacles, our excuses, because somebody needs you. And though you can do it yourself, you choose, you desire, you command us to assist you. Help us get beyond all the fears, all the doubts, all the hang-ups, and to do your will this day and all days. We may not understand it, but you do, and you know what you are about. So we say yes this day. God bless all missionaries. Protect, provide, anoint. Send them what they need. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand for the benediction. Don't stay until God tells you to go. Go until God tells you to stay. Please know that where the Lord guides, the Lord provides. And expect great things from God. Attempt great things for God. God be with you in your mission field. Go now. You are sent.